Man lives in a world of time and space. He lives in a spectrum of the universe. When he ventures beyond this limit, he is in the unknown, a realm where strange forces are brought into play. When man attempts to misuse these forces, he is sometimes destroyed. This is Macabre. The Far East Network presents, in special performance, Macabre. Tonight's story, Final Resting Place.
Like the road. Honey, I think we're lost.
It has to be right, Sue. Justice of the Peace back at Carterville said the lake was on the main highway. We haven't made any turns.
But, darling, it's getting dark. This road doesn't look well traveled. I really think we made a wrong turn somewhere.
Mrs. Kent, your husband solemnly promises to deliver his bride of a few hours safely and surely to Honeymoon Lodge on Mirror Lake. Now, let's hear no more about it. Come on, move closer. Head on my shoulder. That's it.
Roger, you better watch the road.
Why? We haven't passed another car for an hour. Relax, Sue. It's a fine way to start a married life of bliss.
Look, there's a sign. Can you make it out?
Yeah. Randolph, 5 miles.
Are we supposed to go this way?
Sure. What'd I tell you? It's only 50 miles farther. Randolph is our halfway point.
But this country road, how can they call a lonely trail like this a highway?
You're just a sophisticated cityite. Now close your eyes and listen to the radio. We'll be there before you know it.
All right, darling. I guess I'm getting jumpy.
Head on my shoulder and not another word. Okay?
Okay.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin. Authorities at the State Asylum have just issued the following warning. A dangerous homicidal maniac escaped custody this morning and is believed to be in the vicinity of Randolph.
Roger.
He's 45 years of age, weighs 200 pounds, has thick gray hair, and answers to the name of Dr. Vardmore. We repeat, this man is a dangerous killer. Those in the vicinity of Randolph are urged to take extra precaution tonight. Since this killer is armed, the public is warned against walking alone or driving at night on the quiet roads near Randolph. Report all suspicious persons to the county sheriff's office. Now we return you to Stars of Music.
Roger, did you hear that?
Sure, but how does it concern us?
Darling, we are driving down a country road near Randolph. Suppose we should have a car trouble or a flat tire.
Boy, you are getting jumpy.
Let's stop in Randolph for the night.
But, Sue, our reservations at Mirror Lake are
please,
for tonight.
Roger, I have the strangest feeling. If we don't stop at Randolph, we'll never reach Mirror Lake.
Great idea, Sue.
What, darling?
Stopping here for the night? Now we can see the carnival.
It's all right while these people are here, I guess. But we'd better go back to the hotel before they leave.
Are you still afraid?
Well, kinda. Aren't you?
Come on, I'll show you a good time. You'll forget all about it.
Okay. What's that man doing over there?
And now, ladies and gentlemen, if you'll kindly sit closer...
I don't know.
I will demonstrate for you one of the great marvels of all time. As you see at my feet is a hole. An excavation 6 feet in depth. A grave, if you will. And beside me here is a casket. Now, friends, what do you think we are going to do? Now, friends, ladies and gentlemen, have no fear. Tonight, I, Professor Vincent, will select someone, one of you from the audience, to be hypnotized and placed in this casket. Then I will bury him alive for 5 days.
If he's not buried that long, he ain't going to wind up much alive.
Just a moment, please. 5 days at $100 a day. Now what do you say? Who wants to make $500? There is absolutely no danger. A shaft will be sunk so that we can see your head. You'll get plenty of light and air. Food will be lowered to you. Nothing to it at all. Who'll be the first volunteer?
You got as popular an undertaker, pal.
Come now, ladies and gentlemen. Under hypnosis, believe me, 5 days will seem like an hour. The easiest $500 you've ever made. Who will volunteer? How about you, my bumpkin comedian friend?
No, sirree. Last year I took sick with pneumonia. Not sure I end up in one of them boxes.
Did you recover? It's hard to tell from looking at you. You, sir, what is your name?
Roger, he's pointing at you.
I don't think I'd be interested.
Who are you, sir?
Roger Kent.
Roger Kent, does $500 interest you?
Well, sure, but...
Good. Good, you'll make a fine subject.
Now, wait a minute.
And, Roger, who is the young lady with you?
My wife, Sue.
Oh? And what do you say, Mrs. Kent?
Why, I think it's just a dreadful idea. No.
You better pick someone else, Professor.
Nonsense. Do you need the money?
We do need it. But not this way, Roger. It's awful.
$500 would pay off the car. We still have 10 days left for our honeymoon, Sue.
Well, how about it, friends?
Don't let him tempt you. I don't like that man.
It is a lot of money for only 5 days.
We can't wait all night. What do you say?
I don't know.
Say no, Roger.
Speak up. Yes or no?
I hate to turn it down.
You're not going to be buried in that terrible coffin. Tell him no.
Go ahead, pal. We got a first-class cemetery.
All right, everyone. Roger and Sue, time's up. Tell you what I'll do. Think it over. If you decide to go through with it, come back after a couple of hours when the carnival is closed for the night. I'll be waiting for you in my trailer.
Oh, Roger, he wants you. I'm afraid of that man.
Don't forget, I'll wait up for you until you decide one way or the other. Roger Kent, we'll hold the grave open for you.
Listen, Sue, my mind's made up.
But suppose...
Face up to it. We need the money. That's the easiest $500 I ever heard of.
Darling, I know that.
Then what's the matter?
Well, in the first place, we shouldn't be out here in the dark with that madman loose. In the second place...
Professor Vincent seems too interested in me.
Oh, Roger, you read my mind. I'm just trying to protect you, honey. That man, I don't know that... Something wrong.
Admit it, Sue. You don't like the buried alive act. Isn't that it?
Yes, I guess so. It's horrible.
I thought so. Uh-oh. This must be his trailer. Professor Vincent. Mm-hmm. Here it is.
Roger.
Yeah?
If he answers, there'll be no turning back. It'll be too late.
I know. No turning back.
Professor Vincent?
Come in, Roger and Sue. Come in.
Did you really think would come?
I was certain. You see, there is no other way. When I count three, Roger, you will be asleep. Sound asleep on your feet. Then, Roger, you will be placed in the coffin and lowered into the grave for your 5-day rest. Now look deeply into my eyes. Deeply. Inhale and look deeply into my eyes. You're going to sleep, Roger. To sleep. You can no longer move your arms. They hang helpless at your side. Sleep, Roger. Close your eyes and sleep. One, two, your eyes are closed, and now you are powerless to open them. You are free, asleep. Ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to place Roger Kent in the casket. Whom among you in the audience will help me?
I will, Professor.
All right, my friend. Step right up here now. Here, help me raise the lid of this coffin.
Now, give me his feet and we'll put him in.
Careful. He's a big man. There. He's in.
Guy, heavy as a rock. just like a dead man.
Yes, now, close the lid. Close it. Now we're ready to lower into the grave. You see, the casket is supported over the open hole by two chains. If you'll flip that switch the same time I flip this one, Mr. Kent will be gently deposited in his grave.
This one?
Yes. There it goes.
Glory be. Just like a real funeral. Reminds me of the time we buried my grandpappy.
Ladies and gentlemen, in just a few moments, the coffin will lie at the bottom of the grave. We will then place an air shaft down to Mr. Kent's head so that he will be able to breathe. And all of you will be able to see him at 25 cents apiece.
I don't know. I just don't know.
Thank you, friend. You've done your work now. Will you kindly leave? Thank you. You are witnessing the marvel of the age. A human being being buried alive. The casket has stopped. Will another volunteer from the audience help me position the air shaft?
How about me?
Fine. Step up here, friend, if you please.
You picked the right one this time, Governor.
So?
I used to work at a funeral parlor. Handled the stiffs.
Yes, now, just pick up that end of the metal shaft, please. Easy does it. Now, down over the round opening on the casket lid. Careful now. There. Thank you very much, my friend. Neat, very neat.
Okay, Governor. What next?
The shovel. The hole must be covered up.
Oh, sure.
And that is it, ladies and gentlemen. You have just seen demonstrated the marvel of the age. A man buried alive. Mr. Kent will lie there in a deep slumber, the end of which time we'll dig him up and pay him $500. In the meantime, my friends, you may step up here and view him down the shaft for a small sum of 25 cents, one quarter, the one-fourth part of a dollar. Ladies and gentlemen, who will be first among you?
No, sir.
What's that you say?
Dishonest, I say.
What's the matter with you?
Charging money to see him buried alive.
What?
I don't know. I helped you lift him in.
Leave the carnival, sir. Leave here immediately.
That man ain't buried alive. He's dead.
Hello?
Hello, Mrs. Kent. This is Professor Vincent. I got your message. First chance I've had to call you.
Oh, Professor, I'm so glad you did.
What's on your mind?
How is Roger?
I keep telling you he's all right. Now you must stop this nonsense.
Well, it's been 3 days since he was buried, and he just lies there so still. Oh, if I could only talk to him.
Mrs. Kent.
I called down to him, but he never moves or opens his eyes. And after all this time, I know something is wrong. Roger wouldn't let me worry like this. He'd at least look up and smile, if he could.
How many times must I repeat he is hypnotized?
We interrupt this program for a special news bulletin.
Oh, just a moment, Professor. The radio...
Sheriff's office has just confirmed the whereabouts of the homicidal maniac who escaped from the state asylum 3 days ago. This dangerous killer who calls himself Dr. Vardmore is now known to be in the immediate vicinity of Randolph. Everyone is cautioned against walking alone on the streets after dark. If you plan to attend the carnival, kindly do so with friends and leave the carnival in the company of others. Report all suspicious persons. We return you now to your regular program.
Did you hear that on the radio?
Yes, I did.
Oh, Professor, I'm terribly afraid. I don't want Roger alone down there with this madman loose. Please, Professor, dig Roger up tonight.
Mrs. Kent, we made a bargain, a business proposition. Kindly stay in your hotel room and rest. This is the third day. The day after tomorrow, it will be all over for Roger and for you.
Pardon me, ma'am. Are you Mrs. Kent?
Why, yes. Who are you?
I'm the one who helped put your husband in the casket.
Well, why are you talking to me?
I don't know. Just to warn you, I guess. I think your husband's dead.
Oh, you horrible, horrible little man. Get away from me. I'll call the police.
That's you, Mrs. Kent.
Oh, Professor Vincent, I'm so glad to see you. A terrible little man.
Yes, I heard what he said. Now get hold of yourself and listen to me carefully. This is the fifth night. I want you to go to the hotel and wait until the carnival is over. Tonight is the last showing at Randolph. At 11:30, you take a taxi out here to the lot. I'll meet you. Roger will be ready along with the $500.
All right, Professor. Anything you say. Oh, thank God, this is about to end.
Yes, my dear.
It's all about to end.
Are you going out, Miss Kent?
Yes, clerk. And here's the key to my room.
Thank you. I don't think it's wise, though. I mean, you're going out alone. It's after 11 and mighty dark tonight.
The police haven't caught the killer yet?
No. Funny thing, too. Looks like he'll have to leave a fresh trail. You know, kill somebody so they'll have more to go on. Now, why don't you take someone with you?
Oh, I'll be all right. I'm meeting Professor Vincent at the carnival lot. This is the night they released my husband.
I see.
Do you know the professor?
Oh, yes, I do.
Well, he's the one who hypnotized Mr. Kent.
No. Professor Vincent didn't.
What?
Professor got sick 5 days ago.
Got sick? Well, then, who was Professor Vincent at the carnival?
I don't know. Somebody who took his place, I guess.
Here you are, driver. Thank you. Professor Vincent, it's so dark. Where are you? I'm sure the carnival was on this vacant lot, but now there's nothing. Just a few old papers blowing in the wind. Why did I let that cab leave? No light in sight. Those trees around the lot. What if the killer were hiding there? Oh, the place Roger was buried. It was in this direction. This way. Maybe I can find it. The grand will be thought. Wait a second, let me fill the hole. It must be right around here. Oh, where is it? What's this? Mount!
Ah! No. They can't do that. They went away and left you buried. Oh, Roger. I'll get you out, honey. Oh, my darling, I'll help you. I'll dig a thing.
Something is watching me from those trees. I saw it move. I could get out of here. I'll be back, Roger. There's no night filling station 5 blocks away. Maybe I can make it there. Oh, it moved again. There is someone out there. Roger, is that you? No, it's coming after me. It's too big for Roger. I don't know what it is. It's gaining on me. I can't let it catch me. No! Help!
Mrs. Kent, calm yourself, please.
Who are you?
Don't you know? I'm Professor Vincent. I was waiting for you. Now, come with me to my trailer.
No, you're not Professor Vincent.
So, you guessed.
Who are you?
There's nothing to be alarmed about. You're in safe hands at last. I am Victor. Dr. Victor Vardmore.
Not gonna sleep, I guess. Legs feel cramped. Mind's foggy. Can't remember what happened. Sue, where are you? Dark. Pitch black. Must be night. Quiet. Not a sound. I could only remember. Think back. Smells damp, like fresh earth. Where am I? Gotta get up and stretch my leg. No rooms. Wait a minute. There was this carnival. Professor Vincent. Oh, it's beginning to come back. I was hypnotized and put in a casket. Buried for 5 days, yeah. Yeah, it's clear now. Time's up, yeah. They're gonna dig me up now. Boy. The deep hypnotic spell that old boy put me in. I'm glad it's over. Okay, Professor. You can bring me up now. I guess he stepped away from the shaft. Shaft? Where's the shaft? It's supposed to be over my head here so I can see up. Can't see a thing. Cloth-lined coffin lid where shaft should be. What's going on here? I'd like to get out, Professor. Possible they went away and left me buried alive? Oh, no. Professor! Sue! Help! I'm buried alive! Good Lord. Help! Gotta get out. Help me, somebody! Don't leave me down here to die! Help! Push harder! More! No use. Won't budge. Help! I'm gonna die. You left me here to die. Can't call for help. Nobody'd hear me. Carnival left. Nothing up there but vacant lot, edge of town. If somebody came back, how could he tell I was down here buried? Oh, God, don't let this happen to me, please. Help me, save me, God. Don't let this happen. I don't want to die. I'm hearing things.
This is Professor Vincent. Now listen carefully.
Where are you? Get me out of here.
Don't fret. Your oxygen supply won't last much longer.
Oxygen?
You're buried alive, Roger. And I'm not coming back for you.
Not going back?
I'm leaving you buried there.
Well, Professor, I'll kill you.
Oh, Roger, tell me how.
I'll kill
you. Don't excite yourself any further. The oxygen pellet won't sustain your lungs. You are hearing my voice in a small, shortwave receiver and transmitter near your head. I am talking to you from my trailer about a block from you. Sue is with me, Roger. I want you to listen very, very carefully.
Sue, there.
Go ahead, Sue. Tell him.
Oh, Roger, are you all right?
Yes. What's he doing with you?
Please do as he says, darling. He's not the real professor. He's that escaped madman from the asylum, Dr. Vardmore.
He's crazy, Sue.
Please, darling, we have no choice.
Please, quick.
Listen to me. One move like that, and I will kill you both. I've gone to a lot of trouble to set up my final demonstration.
What are you going to do?
I am going to try personality transference. We have the required situation. A man buried alive in mortal fear of death. And the woman he loves who will do anything to save him.
If we do as you say, what then?
I will release the two of you.
And if we don't?
You have just enough oxygen for just a few more minutes.
I see.
Hurry, Dr. Vardmore. Get it over with.
Now, Roger, I want you to think about Sue. Sue, you about Roger. Each imagine he is the other. Roger, you are standing beside me in the trailer. Sue, you are lying down there in the casket.
No!
Cooperate and I will free you. It's your only way out of that grave.
If it works, you mean I'll be in Sue's?
Yes. And she in yours.
Do it, darling. It's our only chance.
He's not Sue.
That's enough. One more refusal, and I'll turn off the shortwave transmitter and leave you in your dark world forever. Now, Roger, imagine you are Sue standing here. Sue, you concentrate on being Roger in the casket. Think. Put everything else out of your minds. I have it. Repeat something you both know. Say the 23rd Psalm. Here we go now. Start with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures.
He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness. For his name's sake,
even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. For thou art with me.
Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table.
Roger! Sue! Help me! Don't leave me down here! The oxygen! It's coming! Save me! Take me up! I'm dying! No, I am!
Thank you.
have just heard Macabre, a special Far East Network presentation. In our cast were John Buey as Professor Vincent, Mitzi Hennessy as Sue, William Verdier as Roger, Milton Radmilovich, Air Force Sergeant Bob Eddy, and Air Force Sergeant Newell Stewart. Technical supervision by Hiroshi Ono. This is Air Force Sergeant Al LePage speaking. Macabre was written and directed by William Verdier.
Macabre comes to you each week at this time through the worldwide facilities of the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.
In a spectrum of the universe. When he ventures beyond this limit, he is in the unknown, a realm where strange forces are brought into play. When man attempts to misuse these forces, he is sometimes destroyed. This is Macabre.
Far East Network presents, in special performance, Macabre. Tonight's story, Weekend.
I can hardly stand to think about it. Such a horrible nightmare. Keep telling myself, maybe it'll help to talk. Try to remember. Put the pieces back together again. But the horror and the terror will never go away. The dead cannot come back. It all began, I believe, about 2 weeks ago, the night of the medical student's graduation party, held at the home of my fiancée, Gloria DuVernay. Ray Stapleton, John Tyler, Gloria, and I were the honor guests. Also, our instructor, the well-known experimental scientist, Dr. Peter Tartano. Tartano and I didn't exactly get along. He suspected I knew too much about the Gaylord case, which connected him with experiments on a hidden island. Also, his unusual interest in Gloria was apparent to me, if to no one else, and formed a further basis for a strong mutual dislike. Tartano didn't think that I qualified as a medical student, but he had to admit I'd passed the exam, so here I was. The party was in full swing when I arrived. Everyone was glad to see me, except Tartano.
Chef, what held you up? No party at all without the three of us together, eh, John?
Gosh, no. Hi, Dick boy. We thought you weren't coming. Got to have the old team together before the fun starts.
Righto. Look, you chaps, come closer. I have a bit of news to tell you.
Say, Ray, you sure got to be there. Shoot.
What is it, Ray?
It's like this. Tortano's about to spring a surprise on us. Killing. You know how tight-fisted the old goat is. Well, he wants to do something for his prize grabs. Nothing extravagant. Just a weekend at his place, or something like that.
What place?
I don't know exactly. Couldn't be his small room at the university, so it must be his other deal.
The one on the island?
Yes, I suppose you're right.
The island? Gosh, you really think he'll take us out there? I don't know of anyone who's ever seen it.
Now, don't let on. I told you about it.
Wow, Tortano's island retreat. They say no one else has ever been on the island. And that he spends his weekends out there all alone.
Doing what, I wonder?
Oh, I don't know. If he's working on something, why go way out there? Why not at the university?
Fellas, there's something about that island you should know.
Steady, Dick. Here comes that lovely thing you're engaged to.
Oh, hi, Gloria.
Hi. What took you so long, Dick? I was afraid you weren't coming.
You knew I would, Gloria.
Don't talk. Just dance with me. Mmm. Nice to be in your arms again, sir.
Yeah. Where's your mother?
In the kitchen, fixing refreshments. Dr. Tortano's helping.
Oh.
Hey, Dick, aren't you drinking?
What? Oh, sure. What you got, John?
You name it.
Scotch and soda?
Boy, you expensive. Okay, coming up.
Gloria.
Yes?
Gloria.
What is it, John?
I don't know how to say it. I still have my internship, and there won't be much money.
Don't talk. Just dance. We'll be married as soon as you like. Oh, darling.
I love you so much.
I say, break it up, you two. You'd think you were the only ones at this party. If you don't mind, I'm cutting in.
Oh, Ray.
Take your hands off this charming wench, Richard. She's mine for a spell. And thanks for the loaner, fellow.
All right, Ray. But only for one dance. The lady is reserved.
Boy, does he expect service. Not only fix his drink, but gotta bring it to him.
Thanks, John.
And just in time. Here comes Tortano out of the kitchen. I think he's ready to talk.
Yeah, looks as if he's had a few, too.
My friends, may I have it quiet for a few moments? I'd like to make an announcement.
I'll give you a proper introduction, Doctor. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I give you a man whose reputation as a doctor of medicine and experimental scientist has astounded the medical profession. Our faithful instructor these past 4 years, the man of the hour, Dr. Peter Tortano.
Thank you, my friends. It has been a most difficult year for all of us. We have worked hard and accomplished much. Now I think it is time to propose a little holiday. So, I am inviting you as my house guest for the weekend. There is plenty of room, 10 bedrooms, 10 baths, 3 stories, plenty of space for everyone.
Wait a minute. Where is this place?
What's the matter, Crane? What are you suspicious of?
Where is your place, Doctor?
30 miles from here. There's a swimming pool, a tennis court, golf course.
Where is it?
Oh, Dick, please don't be rude.
Quite all right, my dear. He has a right to know, and it's on an island 20 miles off the coast.
An island?
Ideal for relaxation. I assure you every detail for your comfort has been attended to.
I'll bet it has.
Well, you can count me out. After 4 years of hell with you, you'll never make a four in 1 weekend.
Dick.
Goodbye.
So sorry, Dr. Tortano. Dick's been studying too hard. He didn't mean what he said.
Of course not. He'll change his mind. The boat leaves at 4 tomorrow afternoon. I know he won't want to miss our last party together.
I knew Tortano better than the others. This was no idle plan. Tortano never wasted time in relaxation. He often said, you have to make every minute count if you want to achieve success. I finally went to my room and to sleep. Hello?
Dick, what the hell's wrong? You still in bed?
What's the time?
Noon, Friday. You'd better get moving.
Oh.
Don't forget the tennis rackets.
I told you I'm not...
Nonsense, old chap. We've all decided it'll be loads of fun. Just what the doctor ordered. Yes. Well, Gloria...
Gloria?
Yes, she's going along. She's right here.
Put her on.
Yes, sure. Cheerio, old man.
Hi, darling. Heck, we're going to have a glorious weekend.
Gloria, you listen to me.
Oh, Dick, we need some fun together. Now, if you're going to be an old killjoy, I'll just hate you.
Gloria, Tortano is no generous soul. If he invited us out there, he's got a damn good reason.
Oh, please say yes, darling. Ray and John want to go. And if we accept, that will make 5. And Dr. Tortano's manservant want us to make 6. What can possibly happen with 6 of us there?
But I can see your mind's made up.
Oh, then you'll go. Oh, Dick, that's great.
I didn't say I'd go.
Now, don't be stuffy.
Well, all right. Your heart's set on it.
Oh, you won't be sorry. Bye, darling. See you dockside.
Yeah. See you dockside. Tortano stood in the bow of the boat like some self-satisfied pied piper. Rain clouds were gathering for a squall as the motor launch strained through billowing waves toward an island looming on the horizon. It was growing dark. A faint light flickered among giant trees taking form in the distance. We landed about 6. It was pitch black. But I could tell by the flashlights that we were surrounded by massive oak trees laden with Spanish moss. We followed Tortano down a gravel path toward a large brick structure taking shape in the gloom. The storm broke as we reached the veranda. Tortano led us into a stately parlor where Wattis, the West Indian manservant, began to stack our luggage neatly in a corner. Wattis was a short, weather-beaten little man who never removed the black Quaker hat from his head. He kept glancing back as if he suspected something were creeping up behind him.
Well, here we are, all safe and sound. Bedrooms are on the second floor. I suggest you freshen up and meet in the banquet hall promptly at 8 for supper.
Even though we had just arrived, a feeling of uneasiness began to reach the others. There were 10 bedrooms, divided evenly by a hall running the length of the building. I selected one across the hall from Gloria. I just shut the door when someone knocked.
Dick, may I come in?
Yes, Ray.
Here's your grip, old man. Wantus brought them all upstairs. Mind if I join him?
No, I don't.
Yeah. Palace fit for a king. Looks like one of those plantations you see in the flicks. But this cost the old boy a pretty penny. You know, I've been wondering, Dick, where Tortano got the money to buy this place.
I believe he inherited something from his father.
Since he didn't make it himself.
Might have. He's a capable man, Ray.
He's a doctor, an experimental scientist. Enough money in that, I suppose.
Well, ever since the Gaylord case...
They never proved anything. Tortano didn't do that.
Well, there was no reason for her to die. Even I could have saved her.
Dick, don't hold something that may not be true against anyone.
I'm not. It's just a suspicion.
Tortano knows you suspect him.
I don't give a damn what he...
Very well. So you dislike each other.
Forget it. Let's get ready for supper, Ray. Meet you downstairs.
Right, Al. If it's any consolation, I'm with you on one thing, though.
What's that?
This weekend out here...
Yeah?
Can't put my finger on it. But I don't think it was planned for fun.
My friends, I'd like to make a little speech. Excuse me. I am not much with words. Just a grumpy little man of medicine. But I always mean well. Now, it's been a long and tedious course these past 4 years. It isn't easy to become a doctor, and the hard part is yet to come for the graduates, that of internship, where you learn to weigh the actual values, where one slip of the scalpel can mean death or a hideous malfunction of the body or the mind. I welcome you to my island estate. You deserve a rest. So make merry and cast the cares of the world aside. Now to bed, children, to bed. Tomorrow will be a day of tennis, swimming, and fun-making. This will be a weekend you'll remember for the rest of your lives.
Aren't you sleepy?
No. Come in.
My bedroom is across the hall. Just wanted to say goodnight.
Please do.
Gloria. Darling, I love you so much. Let's be married right away.
Oh, Dick, you're so impetuous. But I accept.
Good. Are you comfortable here?
Oh, my, yes. Private bath and all.
So you have a telephone, too. All the bedrooms must have them. Well, better leave and let you get some rest. I'll lock your door when I leave.
All right. Thanks for dropping in.
Good night, Gloria.
Dick?
Yes?
Lock your door, too.
Oh, come now. This is a weekend of fun and relaxation, remember?
Don't laugh at me, Dick. I'm really just playing it safe.
Oh, sure. Good night, darling.
Good night, Dick. And please, lock it.
I don't know how long I'd been asleep. It must have been several hours. Something had brushed against my bedroom door. The sound made me sit straight up in bed. Then I heard something else. I thought someone was in trouble.
Who's out there?
Whatever it was, it stopped outside my bedroom door. I turned on the lamp, jumped out of bed, and bolted toward the door. The hall was empty. No sign of anything or anyone. Was it possible I imagined this? When I turned to close my door, I saw it. A dark form bobbing in a doorway at the end of the hall.
I say, Dick, is that you?
It was Ray Stapleton.
Strange sound I just heard. My word, Dick, did you hear it too?
Hey, you guys! What's going on around here? Who was strangled?
Wow, what a gagging cough.
What's the matter? Is anything wrong?
Gentlemen, what's the commotion about? You're disturbing the entire household.
Now, hold on, Doctor. We were just trying to find out who was doing all that coughing here in the hall a moment ago.
Coughing? Nonsense. Must be your imaginations. You're all here, and you look mighty well to me.
Wait a minute. Where's Waters? He's missing. He could be the one.
Waters is standing directly behind you, John.
Is there trouble, Master?
No, Waters. Nothing at all. Now go back to your bedroom and remain there the rest of the night. Do you understand?
Back to bedroom?
Yes. Immediately.
Aye, Master. Waters not come out again. Good night, Master.
But Dr. Tortano, the coughing...
Strictly imagination, I tell you.
But I heard it, Doctor, and so did the others.
There's no one else in this island. So just who do you think it might be?
Yes. I see what you mean.
Imagination is a powerful thing. So much so that under certain conditions, strong stimuli can compel you to think you have actually experienced something that didn't happen at all. Remember, this is the 20th century. We're not in the Dark Ages. No skeletons in the closet or secret wall panels. Return to your rooms, please. Good night, children.
I didn't sleep the rest of that night. I'm certain the others didn't either. They were losing their enthusiasm for the weekend. The next morning, after breakfast, I went for a walk on the beach with Gloria. It wasn't long before Ray and John caught
up
with us.
Hold on, Dick. I want to talk to you.
Hi, fellas. Did you sleep well?
Don't rub it in, Dick.
Gosh, no. We in the first place. That's what we wanted to...
You'd like to give up and go home today. Is that what you mean?
Yes, and all you're making it devilishly difficult. Now, I think we might still salvage a sporting time here. After all, nothing's really happened. But there's been dissension at this party ever since it started. And now there's a feeling of unpleasantness.
We can't leave the island. Wantus took the boat back to the mainland this morning for emergency repairs. He won't be back until tomorrow.
He did.
Wantus has the only boat. There's no other way back to shore.
So we just have to make the best of it.
Dick, I'm with you. I don't think I like old Tortano.
Fine kettle of fish. The island's the kettle and we're the fish.
And Tortano's the fisherman.
Break it up. Let's go back to the house. I have a hunch. I think we'll soon know what this is all about. Tortano spent the day rechecking his notes and shaking his head. I didn't think him capable of feeling alarm, but his composure was rapidly leaving him. We swam a little and played some tennis. By evening, a cloudburst made a valiant attempt to wash the little island out to sea. After supper, a worried Tortano summoned us to the library. As we gathered, he stood up with an air of uncertainty and started to speak.
I wish I could charm you with a graceful speech and make you laugh when I grow tired of talking. I haven't been altogether honest with any of you. I brought you here on the pretext of having a wonderful weekend. That was only partly true.
All right, Doctor, tell us the truth.
You'd better listen to me. There may not be much more time. Last night at supper, I gave you all a powerful stimulant. I tried to magnify your powers of imagination to the point where fantasy could be made reality by varying the dosages given each of you. The one coming closest to fulfilling the experiment would give me the correct formula balance. An overdose affects the respiratory system in such a way that the victim has periods of convulsive coughing of which he is completely unaware. 24 hours after the onset of coughing, the victim goes mad. And if my notes are correct... God forgive me, I didn't mean to go this far.
Yes, Doctor?
If my notes are correct, the victim may become physically anything he might imagine. The coughing started last night. I can't decide at the moment who may have gotten the overdose. I am also suspect, as I too took the drug. There are no guns on the island, no telephone or radio transmitter, and no way to get back to the mainland tonight. So we'll have to remain here. Go singly to your rooms. Bolt yourselves in. Don't open the doors for anyone. Your lives will depend on it. I'm afraid, my children, that before morning, we may have a madman among us.
We locked ourselves in our bedrooms and waited. The others agreed with me. Tortano was insane to invent such a fantastic story. He was the one we should be protected from. We were completely at his mercy. Our only chance was to humor him until Watus returned with the boat and escaped to the mainland. I must have fallen asleep. The storm had subsided to a whisper. Something had awakened me. What it was, I don't know. I lay there in the dark, scarcely breathing, waiting. There was no sound of any kind. Could I have imagined it? Maybe I should get up and look. Perhaps something was waiting for me to go back to sleep before attacking. But what? Nothing could have come into my room. And yet, somehow, I felt the presence of something out in the hall. It was just some sound, some clue as to what it might be. All I could do was lie here and wait for an unknown thing to happen at any moment. I waited and listened. I knew it was out there. Then, there it was. My God, I was trying to scratch open my bedroom door. I reached for a bronze poker on the night table, got out of bed, and tiptoed to the door. It was on the other side. I could hear breathing. Don't open the door, I told myself. It's just outside waiting for me to do that. Even with a poker, I might be no match. Then it occurred to me that it wouldn't be waiting unless it knew a way into my bedroom. Of course, it was coming in to get me. What about Gloria across the hall? Had it already been there? I decided to act.
You, out there. I'm opening this door. If you're still there, I'll kill you. What's that?
Hall lights are out. Pitch black. Something padded off on 4 feet. God, smells like a cat. It's so dark, I can't see my hand before my face. Got to get across the hall to Gloria. Judging by the way it bounded off, it must be at least 15 feet away. If only I had a flashlight. Can't see a thing. Easy does it now. Keep the poker swinging in a circle. I should keep it from creeping up on me. But here's Gloria's door.
Gloria, open your door.
Is that you, Dick?
For God's sake, yes, hurry. Are you all right, darling?
I think so. What's the matter, Dick?
The thing. It's right across the hall.
The thing?
Yes, whatever it is, it's after us. I was afraid it might have tried to get you. Quick, your phone. Where is it?
Right by the bed.
Oh.
What are you doing?
Call the others. The one who doesn't answer is out there. Some creature. Set more light.
Oh, yes.
Really now? It's the middle of the night.
Ray, something's wrong. You okay?
Yes, I'm quite all right.
Good. Meet me in the library in 5 minutes. Ray's not the one. Try John next. Maybe.
Hello?
John, you all right?
Oh, hi, Dick. Sure, why?
Can't talk now. Meet me in the library in 5 minutes. Pretty well cinches it. Has to be Tortano. He's the only one left. If he doesn't answer, we'll know.
Hello, Tortano here.
Oh, no. Who can it be? They're all accounted for.
Who the devil is this?
Dick Crane, doctor. Meet me in the library in 5 minutes.
Are you crazy? Stay in your room and keep it all locked.
There's something fishy, and I'm going to find out who's behind it. Now, you be there. If any harm comes to my friends, I'll kill you.
We're not safe to get in the library. And I don't believe a word of your wild story.
It's true. One of you tried to scratch open my door.
You imagined it, Dick. Here we all are, as chipper as ever.
Pretty obvious. Whatever was supposed to happen hasn't yet.
It happened to someone.
Impossible. We're all still sane. There's no one else on the island. This took place in your mind, Dick. Now let's all go back to our rooms and try to get through the night.
I'm wasting my time with you. All right. I'll stay with Gloria and protect her. But you'd better lock your doors because
someone is going to try them.
Say, Dick is certainly overwrought. He couldn't have been right, though, since we're all so healthy.
Dangerous situation now standing here together. Let's return to our rooms.
Well, maybe nothing will happen.
It could start momentarily. I strongly advise separating immediately. Wait. Hold out your hands.
What?
I just remembered. It's been 24 hours. There is a certain symptom at this time. The victim's fingernails will have a bluish tinge. We can tell who it is. Quick, look at your hands. Hold them out. What do you see?
Here are mine, Doctor.
Normal.
Are mine okay?
Yes, yes.
What about yours, Doctor?
Take a close look.
I'd say they're all right. That means... Good Lord, it's Dick or Gloria.
They've gone to Gloria's room together.
We've not a moment to lose. Come quickly with me.
Dick, where are you?
In the bathroom, shaving. Be out in a minute.
Oh, hurry, dear. I don't like being left alone.
You're locked in together. No one can bother us now.
Oh, Dick, you sound so strange. Please come out of that bathroom. Dick?
Oh.
Dick? Is anything the matter? Dick!
Was Gloria.
Don't look, Ray. I tried to stop her.
No. Well, that couldn't be Gloria. Not our beautiful Gloria.
Whatever it is, it's in peace at last.
So is Tortano. Throat clawed out. As if by a lion.
You have just heard Macabre, a special Far East Network presentation. In our cast were John Dewey, Shirley Ashe, Walt Sheldon, William Verdier, Milton Radmilovich, and Air Force Sergeant Bob Eddy. Technical supervision by Hiroshi Ono. This is Air Force Sergeant Al LePage speaking. Macabre was written and directed by William Verdier.
Macabre comes to you each week at this time through the worldwide facilities of the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.
Beyond this limit, he is in the unknown, a realm where strange forces are brought into play. When man attempts to misuse these forces, he is sometimes destroyed. This is Macabre.
Far East Network presents, in special performance, Macabre. Tonight's story, The Man in the Mirror.
Two lanes here. Why can't they make their repairs on off hours? No, got a blast away during rush hour traffic. What's the matter with that guy I hit? How come he's slowing down? That'll teach him. Boy, I'm tired. Hard day at the office. Peg's got a hot supper waiting at home. I'd like to get there sometime today. That guy ahead didn't pay any attention to me at all. Come on, Buster, speed it up. 76, I want to get home. Okay, I'll pass you then. On four barrel car, I'll leave you in nothing flat, buddy. How's that for speed, eh? Hey, truck. I can see it coming. I'll make it back here on collision. Oh, no, no, I can't get away. See him, Jerry?
So much blood. But I think he's bent over the steering wheel down there.
Shine that light where you mean.
Good. See him now?
Move your light up just a bit.
Like this?
Yeah. Hold it there. Good Lord.
What's wrong, man?
I hope you've got a strong stomach, pal.
What's eating you?
Look down there. Where his face should be.
I don't see it at all.
Yeah. That's what I mean.
Not a chance to save this one, nurse.
Careful, you need to be conscious, doctor.
I doubt it. Another minute or two, and it'll be all over. Sponge the blood, please.
He's bleeding too fast.
Yes, poor fellow. Even if he lived, couldn't get through life like this.
Doctor, respiration irregular.
Won't be long, I'm afraid. Scalpel.
I can hear every word they're saying. I can't move. Paralyzed.
Scissors.
The accident. The truck. I know what happened.
Sponge.
Almost nothing left of my head. Give up, Doc. Try to save me.
He missed
it. Respiration shallow.
Hardly worth the effort. Nothing can save this man.
Please, Doc, don't quit. I know you can't hear me, but please try. Help me, Doc. Don't shake your head. I'm not homeless. I want to live.
Doctor?
Yes?
Respiration stopped.
I see.
Don't give up. I want to live. I don't want to die.
Are you going to open his chest, Doctor?
Heart massage.
Yes.
Absolutely hopeless. There isn't a chance.
He may take another breath in a moment.
Another breath? Yes. Yes, I will. Don't give up. You'll see. I'll breathe.
You'd better wash up, nurse.
Oh, don't leave.
A breath, doctor.
Spasmodic. Probably his last.
Oh, I'm still alive, Doc. Try to save me. Help me, for God's sake.
Stethoscope.
Why did I have to pass that car? I'd give anything to live it over again. Anything. Can't someone help me? Oh, God. Oh.
Perhaps I can, John Randall.
Oh, call my name.
It was I, John Randall.
You're not the doctor.
Indeed, I'm not. Did I hear you say you would give anything not to die?
Yes, yes, anything.
I thought so. John Randall, I'll save your life for a price.
Let me
finish. I can turn back the clock, return you to the freeway before the accident. It will be as if nothing had happened at all.
But that's impossible.
You haven't much choice, John.
It's crazy. How can you expect me to believe a thing like that?
Is he dead, Doctor?
I'll know in a moment, nurse.
You have no time to argue. Decide quickly. When you die, you'll be beyond my reach.
Oh, I'm sinking, growing weaker and smaller.
You're dying. Decide.
It's a bargain.
Good. In just a moment, it'll be 1 hour ago. You'll be on the freeway driving home in your car. But remember, John Randall, I'll be back 1 week from tonight to settle.
Where will I find you?
in the mirror. Just look for me in your bedroom mirror. Goodbye, John. Don't forget our little agreement.
Why can't they make their repairs on off hours? No, gotta blast away during rush hour traffic. What's the matter with that guy ahead? How come he's slowing down? That'll teach him. Hey, just had one of those familiar feelings. As if this had happened before. Strange. Now it's gone. Seems I almost remembered something unpleasant. It's about to pass that car up ahead. I don't think I'd better. Wonder why. Yeah. Can't be. Couldn't have happened. I'd be sitting here driving home. I dozed off for a minute, I guess. Yeah. Dreamed it. Sure. No other explanation. What a relief. I gotta get home. Peg's having steak for supper. And she's one wife who expects a husband to be on time.
My, you were hungry tonight, John. You ate like a condemned man at his last meal.
Peg!
Oh, I startled you, darling. Why so deep and quiet?
Nothing. Just thinking.
John, I honestly believe you've been working too hard. Especially since you fell asleep driving home today. Oh, let's take a week off together and run down to Mother's.
A week?
Yes, dear. We haven't vacationed in 2 years. Not since we were married. Mother says we can have a cottage on the lake.
You called your mother?
Just before you came home. Please, John. She wants us to come down. It's really a very nice lake. And you know how you like to fish.
I don't think the office can spare me.
Ask them.
It takes time. We need plans. I can't just pick up and leave my job anytime I want.
Say yes, darling. It'll be our second honeymoon. And I don't see much of you anymore.
Oh, Peg. What would I do without you?
Oh, not too well, I hope. Darling, I love you.
Come here.
Tell you what. Call that old law firm you slave for and tell them not to expect you back for a week.
But, Peg, I can't...
John! This bruise. Did you hurt your forehead? It's
sore. Don't touch it.
How'd it happen?
I don't know. I probably banged it and I fell asleep driving home.
That settles it. I'll call Mother in the morning and tell her to expect us. You need more rest, darling. Why, one of these days you may be killed driving home in all that traffic. Read the paper now while I clear away the dishes.
All right, Peg. I am overworking. This head bruise. I've never had an hallucination in my whole life. I'll start on now. I'll check this thing out.
City Hospital? This is the City Hospital. May I help you?
Yes. Would you check to see if a man hurt in a collision died there this afternoon?
What was his name, please?
Randall. John Randall.
Thank you. Just a moment.
This is ridiculous, asking about my own death. Must be crazy. Got to know. To be sure. Couldn't have happened. It's all so real.
Hello?
Yes. Did you find it?
Emergency has no record of a John Randall accident victim.
No record? You haven't made a mistake.
No. Who's calling, please?
Who's calling? Lady, you wouldn't believe me if I told you.
What's the matter?
Can't sleep. It's too hot, I guess.
It's nearly 5. Time to get up soon. Want some hot coffee?
Maybe I'll drop off for a nap.
You haven't slept all night?
I don't think so.
John, something must be wrong. You you always sleep like a log.
Don't get excited now, Peg.
Shall I call the doctor? You know, you've been working too hard.
No, I'm fine. Will you keep quiet so I can try to get some rest, though?
Oh, all right. You haven't said a thing about going to Mother's.
Peg, I'm dead tired now. Shut up, will you?
John, what's that on your forehead?
No tricks, young lady. Now turn over and keep quiet.
Darling, wait. I'll turn on the light. John! It's blood!
What?
Your forehead, it's bleeding.
No, Peg. No, it didn't happen. I imagine the whole thing. Accident really didn't happen.
Accident? John, you lie right there. I'll call Dr. Shane.
Don't, Peg.
You must have cut a vein. Look at your pillow. You've been bleeding all night.
Examined you thoroughly, John. I can't find a thing really wrong. But we may have to go to my office for further tests.
How do you explain the blood, Doc?
I don't. There's no evidence of a wound at all.
Where'd all this blood come from?
That presents a puzzle. Of course, we're not really certain it's really your own blood. We'll have to make tests. In the meantime, why don't you tell me the truth?
What are you talking about?
John, I've been your family doctor for many years. You're as healthy as they come. Now you hint of some accident that never happened. You complain of a soreness in the region of the forehead. And all this blood from some imaginary wound. Now, really, what do you expect me to think?
Doc, you think I'm crazy.
I didn't say that.
You don't have to.
There's more to this than meets the eye.
The understatement of the year.
Yeah, put yourself in my place. What would you say?
Send me to the hospital, I guess.
That's more like it. Now tell me what really happened. Start with the blood.
I can't answer that.
If you want me to help, you'll have to tell the truth.
I'm trying to, Doctor.
It couldn't possibly have come from you.
But I...
There isn't a mark on your body. Who do you think you're kidding?
Impossible. Doc, you wouldn't believe me if I told you.
Yeah. Give it a try. I might.
Maybe I should have died on that operating table.
What?
All right. I'll tell you. You'll think I'm nuts, but so help me, it's the truth. All started yesterday, and I was driving home on the freeway. I thought I had an accident.
What do you mean, thought? Aren't you certain?
Let me finish, Doc. I hit this truck. They rushed me to the hospital. I was dying, face torn off, blood everywhere. And then, just before I died, a voice called to me. Knew my name and everything. He said he would save me for a price. I had to agree.
What did he ask?
Didn't say. Just said he'd be back in a week to settle.
Where are you supposed to meet this man?
That's the funniest part. He said to look in my bedroom mirror, and he'd be there.
Then what?
Found myself back on the freeway as if nothing had happened. I got home, I checked the hospital. They had no record of an accident victim of my name.
I could have told you that.
What do you think, Doc? I'm not trying to pull a fast one. I'm scared.
You blacked out for a moment while on the freeway, fatigued from overwork. I've ruled out the possibility of a small stroke. Recovery was too rapid.
Blacked out?
Fatigue acts in strange ways, John. Sometimes makes it difficult to separate fantasy from reality. You've pushed yourself to the breaking point. You'll have to be careful.
You don't believe it happened?
Yes, it certainly did. But only in your mind.
Sounds reasonable. What about my forehead? It's pretty sore.
Probably sympathetic.
That leaves the blood.
If it weren't for that, I'd dismiss you right now with just a warning to slow down. I'm taking a sample of it back to the office with me. I want you to come along.
What about Peg?
Leave her home. We'll call her later. There's something here I don't quite understand.
John, what did you find out?
That's what I want to talk to you about. He's in the other room. He can't hear us.
Is it serious?
The blood on the pillow matches. It's his, all right. But I can't figure out where it came from. He checks normal in every way, with one exception.
Oh?
The results of the EEG test show a brainwave irregularity. Now, it would seem that John received a hard blow on the head. However, I can find no physical evidence to verify this.
What does it mean, Doctor?
Hard to tell at this point. I think he's nervously exhausted from overwork, practically in a state of shock from this nightmare of a freeway accident. That's pure fantasy. You must help him overcome it, Mrs. Randall.
My mother wants us to visit her for a week on the lake.
Splendid. By all means, go in and make John rest.
Do you think he'll be able to leave today?
The sooner the better. And Mrs. Randall?
Yes, Doctor?
Your husband has a fixation about some man in a mirror. It's a dangerous thing. It might grow. Try to convince him it never happened.
Darling, we'll have so much fun.
Yeah, sounds good to me.
Mother's given us the house on the lake where we can be all alone together.
Second honeymoon, Peg.
And we'll forget that thing on the freeway.
We'll forget it.
It didn't happen.
It didn't happen.
Oh, John, I'm so glad you're sensible about it.
Kiss?
Mm.
I love you, Peg.
Oh, I brought the tennis racket.
She talks about tennis at a time like this.
Oh, let's hurry, darling.
Sure, Peg. We deserve one last good time together.
How about some more eggs?
Oh, thanks. Coffee would be nice, though.
Coming up. Oh, this country air is wonderful. 5 whole days of fishing, tennis, dancing and fun.
Pass the donuts, Peg.
Yes, my lord master.
But you're pretty well trained. We'll have to relax like this more often.
Oh, darling, it's so good to see you laugh. We can't let you get down like that again, can we?
I wasn't so bad.
They'll miss you at that old law firm. John, if they don't make you a full partner, you're not going back.
Well, what'll we do today?
Oh, it's beautiful this morning. I know. Take me to the village to shop.
Okay. I get my coat, and off we go.
Honey, haven't you forgotten something?
What?
Mr. Randall, do you realize that in the 5 days we've been here, you haven't shaved once?
I know, Peg.
Well, look at yourself, dear. You'll have to before we go shopping. Here, take my compact and see how you look in the mirror.
No!
John! You ruined it! You deliberately threw it on the floor.
I'm sorry. Really, Peg.
But why? Oh, John, you didn't want to look in the mirror.
Peg.
Oh, what a fool I've been. You're not getting over it. It's growing worse.
Don't cry, darling. I'm trying.
You believe that that man is real, don't you?
I don't want to, Peg. I don't want to.
Dr. Shane warned me about this. He said it's up to you, John. You have to make up your own mind. It's only fantasy. Or you might spend the rest of your life in that other world.
That bad?
Yes, darling. Please, please try.
It's like telling my right hand my left one doesn't exist.
Oh, you've got to try.
All right, I'll try.
Dr. Shane said if you give in, they'll have to take you away. You answer. It's not daylight yet. He's not in bed. Where is he? John? John?
Shh! I'm here. By the window.
What's the matter, darling? Don't you feel well?
Quiet.
Look out there. Can you see anything?
Just the lake, the moon, and the trees on the other side.
Shh! Listen. There is something out there.
Maybe a dog.
No. Dogs aren't that large.
What did you see?
I can't be sure. When I woke up, a shadow was at this window.
My poor darling.
Don't pity me, Peg.
Well, Dr. Shane said fixations with a time limit usually leave after the limit is passed.
Shh, be quiet.
There's nothing out there. Now come back to bed. This is the 7th and last day, darling. That man's not coming back because he never existed in the first place. Please, John, you just have to get by today. And then you'll be free. It's so peaceful in this orchard here by the lake. What's the time?
Almost 7. Time's passed. We're safe.
John, I'm proud of you. You won, darling. You stood your ground and won.
Yeah. Really a sweat, eh?
It just had to end this way. No one believes in witches and phantoms anymore. We're too scientific.
Yeah. I can think clearly for the first time in a week. Now that it's over.
Oh, we have this wonderful lake all to ourselves tonight. Mother went to the village, and no one for miles around. Isn't it romantic?
Thanks for standing by me.
Is that a proposal, sir?
Darling.
What
would you like to do this evening?
Walk around the lake?
Hey, not bad. Hold on while I get some cigarettes in the bedroom.
All right.
Devil's work. He's here. You don't have to hide. I know you're here.
My, my. Quite messy.
You did come back. Where are you?
In due time, friend. You didn't expect me to forget our appointment, did you?
I'm bleeding to death. You haven't helped me a bit.
You were badly mashed up. Difficult to remove all the traces.
What is it you want?
Merely as a timekeeper. To say, time's up.
Dr. Shane says you're a figment of my imagination. So, but you're not real.
And how do you know Dr. Shane is real?
Because I can see him and talk to him.
Can you not talk to me?
I've never seen you.
Look into that mirror.
Ah.
Look! You're a strange lot. You deny the existence of other worlds because you cannot see them. Have you ever seen a thought in your head? Of course not. Does that make it less real?
I don't owe you a thing.
Your agreement was for 1 week of life. That has been fulfilled. You should have followed your destiny and died in the accident. But you chose another path and bargained with me.
My life is over.
Will you join me in the mirror?
Mrs. Randall, I'm the coroner. You know, of course, your husband's dead. Don't see how he could have had such a terrible accident in a bedroom. Main point I can't figure, though, is why you didn't call me sooner. Mr. Randall's been dead a week.
You have just heard Macabre, a special Far East Network presentation. In our cast were John Buey as the man in the mirror, Mitzi Hennessy as Peg, William Verdier as John, Walt Sheldon as Dr. Shane, Carolyn Johnston, and Milton Radmilovich. Technical supervision was by Airman Larry Clements and Air Force Sergeant Bob Eddy. This is Air Force Sergeant Al LePage speaking. Macabre was written and directed by William Verdier. Macabre comes to you each week at this time through the worldwide facilities of the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.
Man lives in a world of time and space. He lives in a spectrum of the universe. When he ventures beyond this limit, he is in the unknown, a realm where strange forces are brought into play. When man attempts to misuse these forces, he is sometimes destroyed. This is Macabre.
The Far East Network presents, in special performance, Macabre. Tonight's story, The House in the Garden.
Our story concerns a medieval castle in the south of France and the strange events that befell its inhabitants. About the turn of the century, its owner, Count Jacques de Marigny, died. His son, the master of his father's estate. This is swept night, a few years later. A black-caped figure strained against the storm toward a towering gray structure looming defiantly above the barren countryside. It raced across a drawbridge into the courtyard like some giant bat closing in on its victim. A moment later, the figure pounded wildly on the massive main entrance of the ancient castle and was admitted by a small, hunched servant who led the visitor into the library before a roaring fire. The man stood, patiently drying himself. Presently, he noticed the gaunt features of something else watching him from a darkened portal. For a moment, the two were motionless. Then the visitor took a step forward and asked,
"Good evening, monsieur. I am Inspector Bordeaux of the Prefecture of Police. I am here in answer to the urgent summons of Count Jacques de Marigny. Perhaps you'll be kind enough to inform him that I am here. Speak up, man. You cannot stand there in the shadows all evening." "Good. That is better. Step over here by the fire, please. Good Lord, man. You have the look of death. What is the matter? Take me to your master at once. Where is Count?"
"I am the Count Dumarty."
"You?"
"Thank God you've come, Inspector."
"Inspector Bordeaux at your disposal, sir. Now, will you explain these rather strange circumstances?"
"Yes, in a moment. Monto?"
"Did you call master?"
"Two glasses of brandy."
"Brandy, sir?"
"Yes, brandy."
"Brandy is in the cellar, sir."
"Cellar? Well, the wine from the kitchen will do."
"Wine from the kitchen. Thank you, sir. Wine from the kitchen."
"Your servant is frightened, monsieur."
"Please be seated by the fire, Inspector. You're drenched."
"Thank you very much. A terrible night, yes. The carriage hardly made the trip up the mountain road. But with the horses barking at the lightning, I did not expect to arrive at all."
"My apologies for summoning you on such a night."
"In so isolated a spot, a patient could die before a doctor could possibly reach him."
"The wine, master."
"Oh, thank you, Monto. That will be all."
"A moment, if you please. Although the wine is fine, the brandy would have been better. Why did you not go to the cellar for it?"
"Go to the cellar?"
"That will be all, Monto. You may help in the kitchen tonight."
"Yes, master. Thank you, master."
"What is wrong here, monsieur? What about this cellar he seems to be afraid of?"
"It's a long story, Inspector. Beginning with the house in the garden."
"The house in the garden?"
"Yes."
"Continue, please."
"I sent for you because our lives here at the castle are in danger."
"Oh? Who threatens you?"
"I am not certain."
"Have you received notes or visitors who might lead you to believe that someone wants to kill you?"
"No. I suppose I'm not making much sense."
"I must agree, monsieur. You are not."
"Will you hear me out?"
"My dear Count, I am a busy man. Perhaps you should have called a doctor instead. No?"
"There may be a death here tonight. You will but listen. I can explain."
"Very well. At any rate, that wine was tasty."
"Oh, have my glass. I haven't touched it."
"Perhaps only a sip or two. I am not a drinking man, you know."
"Of course not. I'll have Montour bring us a bottle."
"Ah, very good. Now, tell me about the house in the garden."
"A little over 10 years ago, my father died. He left me this estate of over 1,000,000 francs. Provision was that I must occupy the castle and remain here to retain title. I had lived in America since childhood, since my mother left my father when I was an infant. It was difficult, but I pulled up stakes and moved to France. And then I met an American student in Paris, Yvette Palmer. We fell in love. It was later that I learned she had another suitor, the Duke de Bastille. She couldn't decide which of us to marry. The Duke became an enemy and threatened my life.
Why did you not go to the police?
Would they have believed me any more than now?
Good point, monsieur. Fine wine.
Yes, sir. Manteau?
Just a sip or two, or perhaps a glass. I am not a drinking man, you know.
Yes, sir. Manteau, a bottle of port.
Yes, master.
Go on with your story.
Well, one night, there was a ball here in the ballroom. I was dancing with Yvette, and everyone seemed to be happy.
Don't move now, Jacques, but guess who just arrived?
Darling, nothing matters tonight except you and me.
It's our friend, the Duke.
Oh? I don't recall sending him an invitation.
Oh, he sees us. Jacques, he's coming over.
Come on. There's no sense in having trouble on the dance floor.
Now, that is a pretty picture, is it not? Too in love.
Please, don't make a scene.
Are you not leading everyone to believe I have lost you?
Keep your voice down.
Oh, you've made a choice all right, Yvette, so it was the fortune that really mattered. You don't want and have not, like me, a man who could give you everything but money.
That's not true.
Go ahead, marry a checkbook and a plush suit of clothes. That is all you are getting. It won't be a man.
Uh-oh. Here goes 30 years of gentlemanly upbringing.
Sorry you said that, my friend.
Oh, watch out! The Duke has a knife!
I'll kill you!
Maybe a difference of opinion about that.
He would have married me if you'd been coming out. And if I assault your throat,
put that knife away, you fool!
Oh, you're so embarrassing. Stop at this minute! Both of you!
It will be over in a moment.
If you kill me, you'll never live to marry Yvette.
Up off the floor. I'm ashamed of you.
Very well, Yvette. I have a better plan to settle our differences anyway. Do you care to listen?
Put the knife away. And I might.
You act like two spoiled children. You're disgraced in front of all your friends.
Very well. Let us go into the other room.
You know, you cut my neck.
Oh, it's bleeding.
You made the mistake of getting me excited.
Take my handkerchief. That will stop the blood.
You know, I don't think you were bluffing.
I would have killed you.
Now, what is this plan of yours?
A wager.
A wager?
Yes.
For what stakes?
One half your fortune.
What? I didn't think I hit you that hard.
What is the wager?
The little stone house in the garden. The one used for storage. I wager I can spend 10 years alone in this house without once coming out, seeing, or talking with anyone.
But it's like a prison. No windows at all. Only a door and a narrow slit at the roof for air. Stone walls are 6 feet thick.
Oh, make it comfortable for me. Get a servant to lower a foot tray once a day through the slit in the ceiling. All I ask is that you send me anything I want to read. I will leave notes to that effect in the empty foot trays, which can be lifted out after I have eaten.
And if you remain for 10 years?
I collect half your fortune. One more thing, though. Yvette should wait until the wager is over before choosing between us. It will be fair, then, as I will have as great a fortune as you.
Suppose you leave before the time is up.
I lose and you are free. Now, to make it legal, we will have a lawyer draw up contracts. The first to violate the agreement forfeits the wager. What do you say, Yvette?
You mean we won't see you again for 10 years?
That is correct. And you must not contact me. Perhaps I will be more attractive to you when I am wealthy.
What if I refuse to do this?
Then I will kill you.
I see. Very well. It's a deal. But remember, we'll all be bound strictly by the contract.
Exactly. Are we not men of honor?
And that's the story behind the house in the garden. The Duke de Bastille has been there ever since.
Incredible. Bizarre. When does he get out?
The 10 years will be up at midnight, day after tomorrow.
Has the Duke kept his bargain?
To the letter. Manteau lowers the food tray once a day, and we hear nothing from him at all.
So? Then why have you summoned the police? Who is that, monsieur?
My wife, Inspector. Yes?
I do hope I'm not interrupting. I must talk to you.
Certainly, my dear. And Inspector Bordeaux, the Countess Yvette Dumarigny.
How do you do? It is my pleasure, madame. Yvette, did you say?
We were married 5 years ago.
I see. She did not wait.
Darling, we can't use the East Wing tonight.
Oh? Why not?
First the cellar and now the servants won't go near them, Jacques. What will we do?
Has something happened, Countess?
Yes. Please tell him, Jacques.
There have been 2 deaths in as many nights. A gardener in the cellar 2 nights ago, and a maid last evening in the East Wing.
How did they die?
Apparently natural deaths, both elderly. Bodies were taken down to a village doctor who said he could find nothing suspicious.
Did you expect to find anything suspicious?
Well, you see...
Inspector, there is more.
Two deaths in two nights under natural conditions. Probably coincidence. Nothing else. Again, why have you called the police?
The drums.
Drums?
We heard them before the gardener died, and again last night before we found Suzette.
What manner of drum?
The kind you might hear in a jungle.
Someone is playing the game with you.
Who? Yvette, Bonto, and a dozen other trusted servants live here with me. There's no one else except the Duke and the house in the garden.
Pardon me, Master. Here is wine.
Yes, Bonto. Put it by the inspector, please.
Yes, Master. I do not mean to hear. I must tell you, servants do not think Duke's still out there.
What?
Last 3 days, Duke not touch food on tray. Trays come back full.
Perhaps the man is ill.
Servants think he find out Miss Yvette Mary Count. Maybe he escaped kill everyone with voodoo drums.
Voodoo?
One of the provisions was that he be allowed to read anything he desired. For the past few years, he's requested books on high and low magic, sorcery, witchcraft, and the like.
So? And when did you first hear these drums?
2 nights ago. We had just gone to bed when they began to beat.
Did you make an attempt to locate them?
No, Inspector. We thought one of the servants was playing on them.
They found a gardener in the cellar the next morning.
Servants very frightened.
It is easy enough to clear this up. Give me the key. I will open the house in the garden.
No, not until midnight, the day after tomorrow.
But it's important to know if the Duke is in there.
My contract states I will lose my entire fortune if I do that. We must wait. Couldn't you send for guards to protect us?
Protect you from what, monsieur? Voodoo drums? Inspector Bordeaux will be the laughingstock of all France. No, my dear Count and Countess. You have made a childish wager with an equally childish Duke. And now you are allowing your nerves to play fanciful tricks on you. I cannot help you. My coat, s'il vous plaît.
The road back may be washed out, Inspector. It's a terrible night.
Indeed, yes. Yes, it is a bad night.
You are welcome to stay the night.
There really is something wrong here. Maybe you can find it.
If drums come again, servants leave, I think.
Inspector, have you tried our grape wine? Best stock we've had in years.
Ah, the wine. Indeed, yes. Put me up, just for the night. Perhaps this does bear some looking into.
Fine. Two bottles of grape, Monto.
Two bottles of grape, Master.
Good, Monto. Mind you, only a sip or two. Perhaps a glass. Remember, I am not a drinking man.
Thank you for remaining, Inspector. Let us retire now to the safety of our rooms. I know that you recognize the danger here. If the drums beat again tonight.
Inspector Bordeaux here. Our midnight drummer went around the corner. With ace, we might apprehend the scoundrel.
Oh, Inspector, we got...
Either way, Inspector, you have the lantern.
I was almost asleep when I heard the sound. You were very wise to summon me. This is either a practical joke or a ghastly plan of murder.
Look, a shadow around the bend.
Hurry.
Wait. That tapestry, it's moving. What is behind it?
An alcove.
Our phantom is probably in there. Careful now. Now, up. Who is this girl, monsieur?
Marie, one of my wife's maids. Is she?
She's gone. A dreadful look of fright. Were the others like this?
Yes. No signs of violence.
Harry, he's getting away!
I must have gone up the West Tower. I handed the lantern. I'll lead the way. Through this door!
A man could fall to his death from this old stairway. Here, take my hand, Countess.
Thank you, Inspector.
See anything up ahead?
Not yet. We're almost at the top landing. And we'll have him cornered.
Be careful, Jacques.
Just a little farther. Watch it. Broken step.
Oh, yeah, we're all right.
Hey, have a gun, just in case.
Easy does it now.
Shine the lantern around.
It has to be up here somewhere.
Look at that post.
Shadow moved.
Where, Yvette?
You, come out from behind that post. Now we know where you are. I have a gun.
I can't see a thing.
Keep on the way. There's something hiding right over there.
It moved again.
Stop or I'll shoot.
No, I didn't do it.
Kindly raise your hand.
No, you must believe me.
Watch out for the guard. Look out for the open window behind you. Francois, poor devil.
But why would he? What reason?
What do you think, Inspector?
Nothing further can be done here. We'll take care of the body in the morning. I suggest we retire to our rooms and try to get some rest.
Oh, so relieved it's finally over, aren't you, Jacques?
I wouldn't fail to go to my door.
Why?
Because, my dear, you are wrong. The real killer is still at large.
Coming, Monto. Hold on. Be right there.
Good morning, Master. Have bad news.
Huh? How's that?
Servants hear about Marie and Francois last night. All leaving.
They can't leave us here all alone. We are here.
They say curse on castle. Everyone die. They not stay. Motona like voodoo drums either.
Where is the inspector?
He having breakfast downstairs.
Tell him we'll be right down.
Yes, Master. But hurry. Inspector plan open house in garden.
Ah, the last breakfast the cook made before she left. May I share it with you?
I'll have only coffee, please. And you with that?
Oh, yes, just coffee.
Monto says you plan to open the house in the garden.
Indeed. It is about time. Or do you both want to die in your sleep?
And you believe there is someone in the castle causing this?
Not necessarily.
Oh, how did you know it wasn't Francois?
The killer we were following had already passed the tower room when we found the dead maid. He couldn't have come back without being seen. Francois found Marie before we did. Afraid we would mistake him for the murderer, he, like a coward, ran up the tower. He accidentally fell out the window.
Master, the servant's now gone. Only we left.
All right, Monto. Inspector, I have a plan. Give me one more night.
One more night, monsieur. May find all of us dead in our beds. There is a madman loose. I cannot risk it.
Monto can guard Yvette in the castle tonight. You and I will take up watch by the house in the garden. What do you say?
I think we should leave this place immediately.
Yvette, how about it? One more night?
Oh, I'm frightened. But if Monto will promise not to leave me.
Monto guard countess with life.
There we are. Now, how about it?
Well, it seems I am outvoted. Very well, then. One more night. However, I cannot guarantee you will be alive in the morning. The storm has passed, but the night is disagreeable, no?
Yes. Turn up the lantern, please, Inspector. It's very dark.
There. That is better now. This is the house in the garden, no?
Right. Made of stone, about 30 feet square. No windows.
So you mentioned. Very quiet in there. Like a tomb, eh?
In a way. Here's the stone door. I have the only key. Without it, we'd have to blast to get in. Hasn't been open since we locked him up.
Uh-huh. And that opening near the door?
That's where his food trays are lured. 6 inches by 24, just a slit.
A foreboding prison. If it is still a prison. I strongly advise you to open it up for your own safety.
He couldn't have escaped.
Who beat the drums? They came from the castle. Not here in the garden. What do you think?
You wouldn't accept my explanation.
My dear Count, please do not expect me to believe in witchcraft or voodoo. This is 1910, the 20th century.
Then we'll hear the drums no more. The Duke is there, and only Yvette Monteau remain in the castle, right?
Exactly. There is no one else left to beat them, if you have assumed correctly.
I suppose we are reasonably safe.
Perhaps we are.
What's that? The drums.
From the castle. Get that! Quickly, we may be too late to save her. Stop. Cellar door.
Drums came from the cellar.
I think so.
I will go first with the lantern.
There's nothing down here except rows of wine casks.
We will be at the bottom in a moment.
You see anything?
Only wine casks. Listen. What is dripping? Wine?
Hardly. Come on.
Dripping is growing louder. Perhaps around this corner.
Something on the floor there.
What? Wait. Monto!
Is he dead?
No. A blow on the head. Monto, quickly. Where is the Countess?
I protect Countess. Someone hit me with them. I
dragged you into the cellar. But where is the Countess?
Inspector, the dripping. It's blood.
Indeed.
Overhead, something lying on that wine cask. Raise the lantern.
It's a woman. The Countess. She's alive. Her face is turning toward... Good Lord.
What happened to her face?
Yvette! Oh, no! I didn't... Oh, God, I didn't do this. I won't believe... She is dead, my friend. This will not help her.
I know who did it. He couldn't stand my happiness.
The Duke... Children,
let's go. I'll get the key. Yes,
I advise you to calm yourself. Where are you going?
To the Duke. Yes, to the Duke. We'll do what he wants at last. We'll open the house and the garden. Yeah.
Most unusual. This door has been locked for years. He could not escape. Monsieur, I am completely baffled. I confess, I do not know who has harmed you.
Monto, help me with this key.
Yes, master. It turned other way.
Oh, all right. Turned. There. Inspector, give us a hand.
Yeah, oui, monsieur.
Door swings out. Here we go now. Pull.
Let me go first. I am armed. Bring the lantern, Monto.
Yes, Inspector.
What do you see? Is he there?
I do not see him as yet. Shine the lantern on, Monto.
Well?
He is not here. He has escaped.
What?
I believe I understand everything at last, Count de Marigny.
Quickly. Where is he, Inspector?
Give me time to think. He could only have escaped with the help of one person, the man who brought his food.
You accuse me?
Yes.
No.
Monto used your key to open the door. The Duke escaped and planned the voodoo drum death with the help of Monto, who did the actual killing.
No.
Monto? But why?
The Duke promised you a part of your fortune. They hoped to frighten you into opening the house early in order to collect your entire estate. And they have succeeded, monsieur. You lose everything.
The Duke broke his agreement first by escaping.
Only after I learned Yvette had not waited for marriage as agreed. Now have you not opened the door and found me here?
You, the Duke de Bastille?
My dear Count. Have I changed so much in 10 years?
You promised you would not tell.
The beard, I see.
I intercepted your summons for the police and masqueraded as Inspector Bordeaux. Then I persuaded you to open the house in the garden, where you found that the Duke had gone.
Inspector, the door is closing. We will try to die. No!
Stop! Don't close the door. We can't get out. We'll die. No! Don't do it, Count!
Heard Macabre, a special Far East Network presentation. In our cast were John Buey as Inspector Bordeaux, Walt Sheldon as the Duke de Bastille, Shirley Ashe as Countess Yvette,
William Verdier as Count Jacques de Marigny, and Airman First Class James Conley as Monteau. Technical supervision by Airman First Class Larry Clemens. Special sound patterns by Air Force Sergeants Bob Eddy and Newell Stewart. This is Air Force Sergeant Al LePage speaking. Macabre was written and directed by William Verdier. Macabre comes to you each week at this time through the worldwide facilities of the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.